correction. It was Brian that abstained, not Romy, and Romy and Schwarzenbach voted no, so there is a change to the minutes. On the public hearing, that was at 7:30, and that, I believe, is on 7:02. Also known as the old meeting.
Motion to approve the corrected minutes.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Bills in between?
You gotta approve that one for the minutes.
Oh, I'm sorry. Motion to approve.
Would we approve the council meeting at the 15th?
I would be in for this.
Oh, and that's not supposed to say 15, but it's supposed to be a special meeting.
Yes, you gotta do a special meeting on the 24th.
Motion to approve.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? All right, bills in between.
Motion to approve.
Second. Any questions, discussion? All in favor of bills in between?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Current claims?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Second, Vice President Caroline.
Discussion? Do you have any questions? The new people, this one, you can ask any questions about the bills.
And really, we'd like to, at least in the minute, just if you come in, if you have a question about the bills, you want to come in and look at them, because that's where I have them. Find the answer. So you can certainly ask them here, but if you wanted to look at those claims in detail first and ask the questions, please feel free to come in and look at the bills and talk.
Yes, please.
I talked to Nolan today, and I went over everything, but would you want to explain, Nolan, page 11, what you explained to me about the third item there? Solar sound.
Right. So for those who have been down by this park, we have 7 new LED streetlights. This is the bill from those lights. They're all LED. We made a quote initially for 5 of them without the LED option. That was $27,000. But with the LED option and 2 additional lights, it comes out a little over $42,000. This was unexpected as a cost. 2 lights came from the vehicle that's light. And the other ones were relocated from their current location to another location in Hot Springs. We replaced ones that were broken in other places.
Any other discussion? Craig?
Can I ask a question? These nameplates, you already had the metal fins at City Hall. Why did you buy new ones? There's a whole set of those down at City Hall.
I don't think no one was aware of the nameplates we had at City Hall when you placed the order.
I was just curious.
They look nice, don't they?
Yep. The other ones did too. Save the taxpayers a couple $100.
Any other questions? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Going to communications from the public. It's 7:14, so we'll just talk very slow about the 7:15 hearing, which is a use permit on review application for Lori and I, Zimmer, Vermont, and she'll repair this.
I know you guys have microphone problems coming out here. It's really hard to grasp.
I can't hear either.
Okay.
Sorry.
Cindy, we can't hear you either. I mean, the activities here next door is just drowning everything out.
Would, Would that be okay?
Do another row?
Yeah, feel free to move closer.
I don't know what's going on in the other room.
A lot of bouncing balls.
I think Chris fixed it for us.
Yes.
Are you Lori? Thank you for coming. There is a little information in your packets as well. So how do you plan to fix, I mean, I've seen the lot, so it's, you know, it's not like a full bay garage or anything, so I think it helped me understand how you plan to do
it. This is basically just going to be for windshield ground chip repairs. We're not going to be doing any automotive repairs at all of any type. It's just going to be if you get rock chip on your window and you want a place to repair, we'll have basically a spot right there that we'll be able to have someone come in and so we can do a repair for on the window and then you'll leave. There won't be any storage of vehicles or anything like that. It's a small lot and it'll be very workable for us and we get the exposure that we're wanting with a sign, so we've got an option, an opportunity to put the sign and get drive-by traffic. That's why.
So it's like the gel that you put into a crack in the windshield, right? Is that what you're talking
about? Yeah. Can I ask a question? Have you done this before? Is this a business you had somewhere else?
Yes. I have had this particular business since about the last 15 years.
Where?
In Sturgis.
I've got a question. Where's all the people going to park to go in there?
It's going to be on an individual basis, so if one person has a rock chip, they can drive in to where we got that concrete spot right there, and it takes about a half hour to fix a repair, and then they'll be on their way.
So there won't be any congestion in the
road? No, there will be no congestion at all.
Did you send out letters?
Yes, I did.
You did, and did you get any back?
I got two of them back.
What did they say?
Oh, no, I didn't, no, I'm sorry. I got one phone call back from one of the neighbors. I gave them my phone number and one of the neighbors called and wanted to know if I was going, what I was going to do with the property and all that, if there was going to be any vehicles parked and all that kind of stuff. So I don't know if she's here or not.
I have some more questions.
Oh, okay.
Jeannie, Carolyn, are you done?
Our building inspector, Barberry, Ms. Barberry, did the letters come back to you so you would know if anyone had a claim? I'm not sure the procedure is.
Yeah, she used the regular certified mail return receipt, and we got all the certificates of mailing, so we know that she did mail them all out. No letters were returned back to our office. I received no phone calls.
I'm short, so I can be heard when I stand.
Okay.
Hello, it's nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, too.
As we're talking about the concrete slab, I still don't have a picture of it. Is that the one that goes around the mailbox?
No, the concrete, when you come up into, you know, where we've got, where you have your, you guys know that little area right there, and then if you come up and turn and drive up that, kind of up your driveway?
Halfway up, or
yeah, okay. Okay, when you turn and go into the, do it after you go down the hill, there is a concrete slab down there.
So I can't even see it.
Yeah.
One more question. You talked about the easement, and I just want to verify that here, just because we talked about that. And are you planning on doing any curb or gutter work to make a driveway, or will that be the only driveway?
That will be the only driveway. I won't be doing, I will not, we were not going to invade any portion of the property at all. Because it will be, it's a good, it has good access for us to be able to get in and turn around and go out. There we won't have any problems
okay.
at all.
Okay, in your own turnaround.
Yeah.
And then when you say put a sign up,
right now we have our sign on the other side. Is that going to interfere with people seeing our sign?
No.
So can you give me about an idea of how high?
I'm looking to put it back far enough that it's not going to be a visual. So if someone comes up to the approach, they'll be able to see without any problems. And I'm not going to have it high. I'm going to have it low. So it's more in eyeball vision distance.
Okay.
So it's not going to be invasive to your sign or our sign.
Okay. I just like to ask to clarify the easement. I'm quoting Lori here, but she sounded like she knew what she was talking about. You said 25 feet easement from 385 and 15 feet easement off of Sherman Street. Can anybody verify that for me?
Sherman Street is Highway 385.
Well, ours is Sherman Street, too. We got two Sherman Street we're talking about.
What are the sign restrictions or requirements?
Borders on three separate roads. It's Sherman and what would be an extension of Pacific and then the back driveway area. So we would actually consider it three front yards since it's on Main Street, so it would be 25 feet per side as far as building structure. As far as signage, you can go up to 10 foot to any property line. So she could move it forward as far as the sign goes, but she and I have discussed the idea of actually whenever she goes to set her sign, have somebody hold up a piece of plywood about the same size, have somebody sitting in the car making sure that viewing cone is open and available.
Okay. Will she have to get a state permit to do that?
It depends on where she puts it. If she puts it closer to the extension of the Pacific, she would do that just with a city permit and avoid the state.
Ms. Jeannie?
And I understand you bought that lot, that whole lot, right?
Just from the highway into the area that you know when you drive up that driveway, that's the only area you get out.
Okay, so you bought it.
We didn't buy anything on the other side of the highway.
I think it's very, I really like the idea that we're getting more business in town. Even if, I wish you the best of luck. The only concerns we have is, of course, having a lot of cars or anything out there that we mow that lawn even though it's not ours. We keep it up. We do a lot of work down there to make our presentation favorable. But I really am in favor of seeing some more business come to town. So under them understandings, my husband and I wish you the best of luck. But if anything should change, we will come back to the council.
Okay.
All right. Thank you, Lori.
And that is mixed use.
It is mixed use,
yes. Yes, sir.
What about the people just stopping to inquire what's going on there, what the business is about? It'll be coming down to our door, which is only 50 feet away from there.
Well, what we're going to do is on our sign is we'll have a sign and it will give a phone number and it will say by appointment only. And they'll know that if they want to, they're going to have to call. And what we're going to do is we're going to say call by appointment only, and we'll have a phone number on there so they'll know they have to call.
Okay, the turnaround now, they're going to be turned around in front of our trailer down there. That's a big spot for them. We don't want that.
Well, then we can easily put up a sign that says do not.
I never received a letter of any kind. I heard you say you got a certified, but I wouldn't know if Steve had shared it with us. I have a cool house there, and it's right across from where you guys purchased your place.
Uh-huh.
And who's going to do the upkeep on the driveway? I mean, Nicole had the feeling when I talked to her tonight that was her driveway and that maybe you guys didn't even have access to. I don't know if that's right or not. I haven't had time to check it out because I just found out about this. I mean, I never received a certified letter. So I'm just kind of curious about the upkeep for the road and all that.
You you the property owner?
My daughter is, and she lives in Wisconsin.
Would have gone to the owner.
Well, but I've already gone and talked to the tax people, and they have everything sent to me now, because I pay the taxes and everything.
I don't know what happened with your certified letters.
Well, Nicole didn't give one, neither did I. I mean, I don't know. I wouldn't have known if Steve had shared.
We don't have you within 200 feet. It wasn't on my list of the properties within 200 feet. But
the house is
the point of the matter is you at least made it here. Your team this week, I think that's pretty important.
Well, I got to get to it. I don't know. I want to know what's going on.
Well, did you see the sign too?
Well, I live by Maverick, and I work a lot, and I don't get on that end of town unless somebody doesn't pay the rent or I'm on there. So, I mean, it's in the summer when we're busy, it's not my, I don't go check all the time. I don't go there a lot, so.
Well, I have a question. How is the road taken care of right now? Do all of you guys pitch in and put money in for the gravel? If you do, we would gladly pitch in and put money into the gravel as well to maintain
well,
it.
Well, I think that Steve, as far as I knew, Steve's always just played it at Idle Park. Everybody's just gone in and out and done their thing. But the whole thing is that there was never any other property people there. I mean, not really. Nobody lived there or had a deal there. So nobody was supposed to be using that driveway other than Steve and us, really, until you guys moved there. And I don't even know that you guys have, I mean, I don't want to cause trouble or anything, but I don't know what the access is or anything. I mean, there's some things to find out.
When we looked at the property, when we looked at our plot, so to speak, the driveway that is on there goes across the edge of our property. From where we looked at the pegs and pins, most of that road is on our property.
I really don't know. That's what I said. I just found that last night. I've never even investigated or did anything. You know, Steve, what the...
I'm going to have an easement.
Well, I have to look up the actual...
But I'm not even sure right now. I walked in late, I'm sorry. But I'm not even sure what kind of business you're putting there, and I mean, it's just gonna...
It's not gonna be an invasive business by no means. We're just gonna do our chip repairs. And much less, it's also not going to be, when I'm saying that we're gonna be doing rock chip repairs, there's gonna be times when someone's gonna call and they're gonna say, I have a rock chip, and they're gonna say, this is a mobile business as well, so I can take this business to their place of work, and I can fix a rock chip for them at their place of work too. So it's not gonna have to be just right there. So it's not going to be incredibly invasive into the property.
I got one more question. That hill is very, very slick in winter time. Few people can go up it when they're in the car. Like that. You've had to help people up the hill. Now, what are you going to do when it gets ice on it?
When it gets ice on the road?
Yes.
Well, if it becomes a difficulty, then when we talk to people of giving them rock chips and stuff like that, we can easily tell them I can meet them at some other place and do a rock chip for them some other place. And the majority of the time when we do rock chips, it would probably be more in the summer than in the winter time anyway, because they're doing a lot more road work.
Are you talking about Pacific?
Yeah, that's a question. I'm trying to figure out what hill you're talking
what
about.
What are you talking about that goes up the hill?
It drops down to Jackie's place and then to our place below hers.
It's a driveway.
Huh?
It's a driveway.
It's a driveway. It's not, I don't even, it's called Sherman Street, but it's not, it's just the driveway off Sherman. Our address is Sherman. But it's just a driveway, and it's got a steep incline, and I mean, you're in the winter, you got to back up and get a run out to go.
She would be the first turn on off of 385, correct?
Yeah, we're right at the bottom of the hill below Lock Hill. And believe me, I'm all for more business. I want more business in town too, because it helps everyone. But I don't want to see a nice, quiet little residential
place become, if it becomes excessively busy, I can go out and do it at their place of, at their home or their place of work or wherever. I don't have to be there. I'm more interested in getting the exposure for the sounding than I am for using the spot for doing work. Because if it's a better place to have it out there, I can do it out there. I don't have to do it at that shop. You know, it's just going to be a little bit more added convenience is what I'm thinking. And in the summertime as well, when someone is traveling through and they get a rock chip on vacation and they want to get it fixed, it would be a little bit more convenient to be able to stop in and get it fixed and go on their way.
Right. I do need to start the other hearing.
I'd like to move this to the next meeting in the month of July. And we need to find out exactly where the easement is. Okay? And that'll tell us whose property is whose and what portion belongs to you and who has the right to use it.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? We're going to check into the easements and then we'll...
It'll be old business. There is a decision now.
Okay.
It'll be a general business the next week.
Okay. And if Kim gets that information...
And the sign should stay in place until the hearing is closed.
Right.
Okay.
Was that tabled? Until the next meeting?
Table to the next meeting.
Thank you.
We'll let you know if we have any other questions. Kim will do as the council requested.
I have a question. Should I be here at the next meeting or?
Sure.
Yes.
Okay. I think it would be good for you. I am now going to open the public hearing for the use permit review for Bonnie Brighton. Use change, museum and residential use of a commercial property at 706 Jennings Avenue. Hearing's open.
Do you want me to speak?
Sure.
I didn't know how you wanted to start.
I won't make you.
That's right.
It would be advantageous to you to speak.
Good evening. My name is Bonnie Brighton. The purpose of the public hearing, my part of this public hearing, is to determine if I can have an apartment at 706 Jennings, the former NAPA building, and also create a toy museum at that location. One thing I want you to know is I only learned a few weeks ago, about the first part of June, that this hearing was part of your city requirements. So I apologize, but I had no knowledge that this needed to be done. I did, however, know that I needed a building permit, and I submitted plans and received a building permit addressing all of the requirements that the city had in terms of creating a living space. Most of those concerns had to do with fire safety things, such as the thickness of drywall, fire-rated doors, and things of that nature. All of those requirements have been met. State inspectors have approved the plumbing and electrical installations that have been done. And so I'm very near being done with meeting all the code requirements for a living space. Something else you should know, that this is a very small studio apartment, approximately 400 square feet out of a building that's approximately 4,000 square feet. So it will never be a rental unit. It is solely for my use when I'm here. This business will be a seasonal business, probably maybe the middle of May to the middle of September, maybe only 3 months, just a short amount of time out of the year. So those are things that I think are probably pertinent. Like I said, it's going to be a toy museum. There will be a small admission charge to help me cover the cost of operating the business and paying the expenses that are involved in that process.
Are there any questions, Wes?
When you applied for your building permit, did you disclose to the building inspector that you were going to put a building
department in there?
Oh, yes, absolutely. And I have communicated.
He never mentioned one word by.
Not that this hearing was required. I said, like I said, I don't live in South Dakota. I grew up in South Dakota. But I was only going to be here for part of the year. And so in order to do this business, I had to have a space to live while I was running it. But at no time, and actually I, in a meeting, indicated that it was a toy museum and that I required a living space. All of the communications and the documentations I received from the city had to do with the requirements, code requirements for fire safety in a space that's lived in.
You never mentioned a use on review or anything of the such?
No.
Okay.
If I would have known this hearing was necessary before I bought the building, I would have had this hearing. Because, like I said, I don't live here, and so I have no reason to own a building in Hot Springs if I can't use it for my intended purpose.
Any questions?
Yes.
Your building doesn't have a basement, does it?
It does have a basement, yes.
It does have a basement. Is it used for storage or what?
Yeah, for me it'll only be storage.
It
does have a basement, yes. There's a crawl space probably to the first half of it, so it's in the back part of the building. There's some shelving down there, and then there's some, I think it's probably an old fuel tank, probably a part of an old furnace and stuff like that. So it's nothing other than storage for me.
Maybe like my basement. did you send out letters?
Yes, I did. First, it was indicated to me that the city would do that after I paid the $150, I guess, application thing, and then I was told I had to do it. So I did that from my home in Colorado, and so I provided to the finance officer the results of those. I believe there were 14 people on the list. I got 6 responses, but I sent out all 14. I got those responses on Thursday. Didn't get anything on Friday, but then we had the holiday, and then I probably have some more in Colorado today.
What were the responses like?
All I got was the signature card.
You didn't get any comments back?
I have gotten no comments back from anybody, correct.
The city, no negative comments? That's all the questions I have.
Is your apartment towards the back?
Yes, in the very back. Again, part of the code requirements require exits out, and so yes, in the back. And like I said, it's only one corner of the back, 400 square feet out of 4,000 square feet.
For the council, how are you viewing this request as it relates to the business next door to her that was made last week, that there was concern about having a business and an apartment in the same building when it's on Main Street, it should be a business, not a residence.
I was just about to address that issue, Bob.
Thank you.
Thank you for bringing it up. It's my opinion as president of the council that we have to follow our ordinance. And if our ordinance does not allow it, we need to have a discussion with the owner of the property with regard to what we need to do to try and satisfy your costs with regard to putting in that apartment. It does not fit the ordinance, and the only way we can fix that is to change the ordinance. And that's a lengthier process than we're going through right at this point in time.
Wouldn't that be a long-term solution, though, because of the latest outpouring of people looking to do this? I've talked to multiple people. Donald and being one of them, other members of the Development Corporation.
Brian, we need you to speak up.
It might be to the point where it's time for an ordinance change here. There's been a lot of requests for it. There are a lot of people that do live in their businesses that probably aren't identified. I'm not going to say names, but we know many of them. You know, some are legal, some are not legal. I've renovated businesses for people downtown that live in the back. Parks on Quilts is one with Brian Powers. You know, it's attached. It's in the back, it's not technically upstairs. I think we do need a remedy. The situation's happened here, Carl, you're right. You know, somehow it's got to be remedied. And from Shedco's standpoint, we'd like to see some progressive business growth we'd like to see a better storefront here than an empty storefront, because she's indicated to me that if she can't live there, she's going to put it up for sale. And God knows how long it's going to be on the market for, and that's another empty building. While we are in poor growth, we're not going to tell you what to do, but I think it's probably time to update our ordinances and zoning to allow it on a case-by-case basis with criteria. And that criteria, I think she's in on it already, in the fact that you're going to live there because you're running a business, not just because you want to live there. You can buy some cheap buildings on Main Street and live there. No, you can't. You've got to run a business there. You've got to produce some tax revenue for the city. That's why you're in business. It's just you and your spouse. It's not for a bunch of people that come to stay and visit. You can't sublease it. If you decide to sell the business, you can't give that with it. They have to reapply to get that permit. Off-street parking, you know, require they park in the back or 2 blocks away someplace to maintain that storefront parking area. There's a lot of criteria. I would recommend you send this to P&Z and let them hash through it, and then have a hearing like this to get the input, because we don't want to step on the toes of the existing business owners on Main Street either that have already followed the rules per se and may have done it in this scenario. But for the time being, I think you need to help her out. Let's get her open, and then let's look at doing the ordinance changes to allow it. This is just a year. Use time review is year by year. You're correcting me if I'm wrong. So
give her a chance. Well, they can't be for multiple years.
No, I'm saying if it's for a year, in that year, let's get that year to get the P&Z get in there and get some hearings and maybe look at changing this ordinance. Let's be more positive growth on Main Street.
Yeah, I've actually received a request that P&Z look at this on the 15th. I talked to Kim about that earlier. She's added it to her agenda, so City Hall, 7 p.m., 15th, we will be looking at that.
What was your name, Brian?
Spitzer.
Brian, I would love it if you would be there. That's a really good idea.
And let me mention also, sir, I'm a law-abiding person. Had I known that this hearing was required, this would not have happened in the sequence. I would have had a choice either to have this hearing before I purchased the building and gotten approval, or I simply wouldn't have purchased the building. And you're talking about a financial compensation, but I'm in a very difficult position because I now own a building, have built an apartment, spent thousands of dollars, and I still can't do what my intended goal was. And that information was conveyed to the former building inspector before I started. And at no point did he say, before you do this building permit, you need to have this hearing. Before you buy that building, this hearing is required. So I acted in good faith based on information I got from your employee. And so, like I said, I'm in a very difficult position, and I'm behind schedule, but as these things go, they never quite go as you plan them, for a lot of reasons.
Well, I understand your position too, ma'am. How long have you owned the building?
I purchased it in 2013. The building permit was issued in January of 2014. Some of the preliminary work was done after getting approval on the plans and stuff. Building permit, I think it's January or February 2014. Did some initial deconstruction to move things around and try to, you know, use what was there as much as possible. Framing was done last summer, and it took me until November to get a commercial plumber who had 2 days to come in and work. So those are things that are out of my hands. And then I had a similar experience with an electrician. And I'm glad that those people are busy, but you know, when you have a very small business, it's very difficult. And then it compounded my difficulty. And again, I'm sure you don't care about this. But again, I don't live here, so it makes it difficult when I don't have a place to stay for long periods of time to get this done. So,
well, I appreciate your position quite a bit. We're glad to see your Colorado money come to South Dakota. But I think this is another issue in which we need to table this until the next meeting to have some discussion with regard to it and have you come back after we have PNZ, make a recommendation to the council. And if that means changing the ordinance, so be it, you know. If we don't follow our ordinances, which are our laws, we're in violation and we can be penalized for not following our ordinance. So if we need to change that ordinance, so be it, let's get it done.
Can I ask, had you planned on opening this up?
That was my hope, yes. But again, once I find out about this hearing, then I return to Colorado because I thought I can't keep spending money on something that may or may not happen. I have applied and I have a registered name with the state. My business is going to be called the Museum of Childhood. And that's as far as I've gone. Again, just pending the outcome of this and what I'm going to be allowed to do, or have to look at my options based on whatever decision you all make.
Well, again, I have to make a motion to table this issue until the next meeting.
Just one question.
I had three people that were on four now, but then we're done.
What's
Jean,
the time?
Bob, Craig, and Chris, and then we're done.
What is the time frame, Carl, that you're talking about when you change an ordinance like this? Could you give us an idea? And also, does the council individual, each individual member, have any pros or cons about looking at changing this ordinance? That's what I'd like to hear.
Well, it's on the agenda for the Planning and Zoning Commission on the 15th at City Hall at 7 p.m. And we look to that commission to give a recommendation to the council. When we change an ordinance, there's two readings.
Then 20 days has to pass after the second reading has been published before it becomes.
So it does take a bit of time.
Okay.
So I'm glad to hear that the council is considering looking at this and see what is the best way forward. So the lady that was in front of you folks last week, is she not grandfathered into this process? Will she be contacted so that she can offer her input
right
in the same
there.
Fashion?
No, I think what's going to happen there, Bob, is that we're going to have a re-hearing with regard to the lady of 702.
I've already got the application.
Okay. So it's, you know, that's something that's going to progress along with Bonnie.
Thank you.
Okay, Craig.
Bob already asked my question.
Chris. You guys, we're going to do this in order. Chris, did you have a comment?
Yes, I just believe, like, as a current candidate for mayor of 2016, I believe we need to have some true positive change in our downtown storefront, because right now we got buildings that are empty, and if you have two people here that want to put in businesses and they want to also live in the back of their business and it won't disturb their businesses, I think it's a win-win situation, because they, when we have tourists coming in during the summer and you see all these empty buildings, they'll say, why in the heck do we want to come back to Hot Springs?
Chris, that is exactly why we're going to planning and zoning with this, and I agree with Mr. Spitzer and his comments with regard to this issue.
Carl is just stating that what we have to do, and we do have to change our ordinance to make it comply. And we are willing to look at that on the 15th, 7 o'clock, City Hall is on the agenda. And I didn't see any other comments for this hearing. So
did you have?
We're basically in the same position she is, that we don't end up being able to stay there while we're in town to operate it, then we may as well sell it or knock it down. There's one other issue that everybody needs to address here. The stairwell that goes up the side there, the rock one, is hollowing out underneath. So
we're
going to...
Thank you.
I'm taking care of that. I'm photographing it now.
Great.
One
you.
Of the things the public needs to understand is we have to follow what our attorney recommends us to do, and that's why we're going in the area that we're going. With a rehearing on yours and continuing yours to avoid your touch. Did I have a second on my motion?
Yes.
All in favor?
Aye.
But we're not voting.
If you vote to table,
you've got to vote to table.
I'm closing the 7:30 hearing for the use on or permit on review for Bonnie 706 Jennings.
Motion to second.
Motion to second. All in favor?
Us? Do you want to keep that open as well and sign on it or until it's closed? Just a table.
Yeah, I don't. I think we need to.
If you close them, you have to listen to them.
Yeah.
And you don't want to close them.
That's what she said. So we're tabling the hearing.
Yes.
The decision. Okay. Is that all clear? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carried or table carried. Okay. I was going to look at all the personnel as one item, A through M. Okay. Item A, communications from the public. Joe Pickron, are you present?
Thank you.
And Joe, keeping us busy. We appreciate that.
Hey, Rob, my receptor license available in the city hospital. So, I'm just moving.
Can you? Speaker,
talk
loud. I can barely hear you.
Tony Howell, that's off. Is there a liquor license available or might be coming available?
Joe, I understand that we do have a license that is available, but do you not rent the Evans?
The Red Dog River Resort.
We own that. Can you apply for, can he apply for a license as a restaurant?
He could.
He doesn't have a restaurant.
A percentage of his revenue would have to be food related. I think that's 50%.
And you're not planning to do that, so you would
an open restaurant, but eventually you're home.
Because there is a restaurant license, but you do need to sell, I think, 60% food.
Yeah.
60-40.
And you would, you're planning on doing a liquor license prior to the restaurant?
Yeah. We want to have, like, trying to have wedding receptions and stuff down the road.
Okay.
Well, have we done research on what the last one sold for?
No, we haven't.
And we need to do that before we can give you an idea of what we want to sell it for.
Okay.
Do you have a time frame?
But thank you so much.
October, I'm having a wedding. I thought it
was okay. Well, that's important. Okay. Craig.
On the liquor license. You can't use the restaurant license. You have to use a regular liquor license to go clear back to a regular liquor license.
That's correct.
Because the restaurant license is like $7,000. If I remember right, the regular liquor license is like $16,000. In that ballpark, something. Because the last one that sold was.
I thought it was $25,000.
I don't think so.
Yeah, I do.
Well, we will research that. Let's not speculate.
Well,
we don't want to
sell them. It's just in theory, but
what's that? I don't think we should speculate on what the last one sold for. As
no,
much
she
not
the amount to know which one, because we have to research it. So that would be helpful.
It is not a restaurant license. It would be just a straight liquor license. Liquor, not malt beverage. You already got that straight.
Yeah.
That's what he said. He said the last business. So she was asking which last business was the
last. Was that? It was either Woolies or Jenny's Rep. Because
we'll look into that. Joe and we'll keep it on the agenda until we get an answer to you.
Thank you, Joe.
Thank you. Any other communications from the public? Yes, Barbara.
I have a safety concern.
Okay.
At the street dance that over the 4th of July,
mm-hmm. one of the ladies that I was, well, her husband was sitting between her and me, and she got hit in the back of the head with one of those rocket flare things. And I personally don't feel that fireworks should be set off at the street dance. They were all over the place there. So it's just my own personal opinion. I think it's a safety issue.
Was it an item that is normally shot into the air?
It's one of those that you hand throw, and you throw it up, and then it takes off another direction.
It's a zinger. Huh? It's a zinger.
I have my idea. I never buy it. No. But I just, you know, in a lot of the, I saw a bunch of little toddlers with sparklers, and one of the kids was knocking the other kids down, and one of the girls fell on one. So I don't know if she got burned or something, but they were shooting them off right in the dance groups, and I just don't think that's, I think that's a safety issue.
I agree with you.
Yeah.
Sure.
Now, did you have your hand up?
I was just going to go to the next.
Anything else, Barbara?
I don't know. That's just that I just, you know, since she got hit in the head, we didn't shot her off.
This is just a personal comment, Valerie Henry. For 4th of July, we used to have fireworks up at Butler, and then we moved it out to the landfill. I don't remember what all the reasoning was, but I've always thought it was a bad idea because we're lining our highway, a state highway, with children, and it's chaos, and half of the people who used to be able to see fireworks can't. The residents used to sit out at the Evans.
It was the library.
At the library, yeah.
No, it was because of the construction at the library that it had to be moved from Butler Park out to the...
Okay. But, you know, like the Evans residents at the Evans used to be able to sit outside and watch them, and you can't anymore. I live 2 blocks away, and you can't because it's so close, they don't go as high. But, well, that's neither here nor there, whether you change that. But 3 days of fireworks... does cause a lot of problems for a lot of people. I have kids who absolutely love it, of course, but does that mean that I'm not having to stop them and make sure they're in bed at night? No, it does not. It means I have to stop and make sure they're in bed at night because fireworks are like an addiction for kids. And the police were running like crazy all weekend. I just think when we had a place, a central place, not a state highway to get kids killed on, where we did fireworks, I think it helped. And when it turns into a community thing, although for my entire life we've always set them off in my driveway, but the bigger ones we always had to go to wherever they were. I just think
it's not a lot
personally
of
people
this year.
Well,
it's
just,
right outside my back.
It's an ordinance, correct, Nolan? Or
it is.
That there, you know, that we allow fireworks from July 2nd to the 4th, I believe it is.
But there's a time on it, 10 o'clock on every night except 4th of July, and it's midnight on 4th of July.
I don't think there's a time limit.
It was in the paper.
The time.
Dates, I know.
It used to.
Well, our current ordinance is not.
I thought it was just our noise ordinance. But anyway, all I wanted to say was that I just thought
I prefer
to
Butler Park myself.
Yeah.
So I can lay in the park and.
I think one of the things you have to come back to is that at the time that it was moved from Butler Park, it was a safety issue and a fire problem, and the library being part of that problem. So that's why it was moved from Butler out to the...
I understand for the big ones, but that's why, because, and I get that, even if I don't personally like it, that's kind of irrelevant. But I still think Butler would make a bad place for people to come with their sparklers and everything else and do their thing, and then our police don't have the entire city. You know, they were zipping around like crazy. They didn't have a chance. They didn't have a chance of having any control over that. And I will give them credit. They were trying.
We're trying.
I think there's a part of that is that the reason they moved it was because of, and I could be wrong here, but I understood that there was houses and buildings too close to where we were setting them off when they were doing it up at Butler Park. o'clock.
Fire safety.
That it's a fire safety regulation rather than we just moved it to move it. Because I think we had a problem with that. The first couple of years I was here, the guy that was setting them off for us at that time, I think Carl Oberlitner run into problems because of the locale.
By no means am I saying my children were perfect. I was up at 11:30 taking some heavy ammunition from them at 1 o'clock. That's all.
Thanks, Val.
Yeah, Bob.
I just have two questions in that same vein. The first one was, there are certain fireworks that are legal to be done in town. The mortar rounds, I mean, is that legal for in town? I thought it was just sparklers and lady fingers.
I think it's a 10-foot height.
And anything?
It's posted in the paper, and it's also on our Facebook page. It's on our website. There's certain restrictions on what can and cannot be used in town. A lot of the novelty items, like sparklers, is permissible, but mortar rounds are not allowed.
So the things that were shaking my windows at 12:30 the other night are not legal?
And that's why the
that brings me up to my second question. How many citations were issued over fireworks?
I do not know that.
Anybody want to venture a guess?
I spoke with our police chief this morning about the weekend's activities.
Yeah.
They had over 15 arrests, not related to fireworks. They did confiscate some fireworks, but as Val mentioned, they were chasing the radio all night. They were certainly active, and it wasn't just fireworks.
What I saw was I did see them taking fireworks. I saw him taking fireworks for people and stuff. I gotta give him credit. My block was so smoky, I coughed. And it was like, hey, calm not night. Like this. This was like
summer time.
In response to what Barb said, I was also down at the street dance. I was down there until probably 11:30, quarter to 12. I didn't see any police officers running around, but I saw three of them walking through the crowd, and I would think if there was any problem, they would have done or said something. So,
I haven't talked to my meetings with the chief is tomorrow, so I'll know more tomorrow about it. I don't know who's first. Ladies first, tell us.
The lady did go over and speak to the three policemen that were by the fire station. But we couldn't see where it came from, and they were busy talking to these other teenagers and stuff. You know, because when they were, those teenagers was doing something, they were taking them out of the crowd, over, which I commended them for that, you know, taking them over towards the Garazza fire station, you know, and they said, well, they didn't see it either, so there was like wasn't much they could do, but she didn't. Thank you.
Chris? Two things. First off, do we have any plans to fix our roads in town? Because I ride my bike to work a lot, like up at the state home, and it gets very hard when you're riding on a lot of potholes and uneven roads. So I'm just curious if we have plans in the works to fix our roads.
Constantly, yes.
And then second of all, I've helped Kim out a few times the last few years for the New Year's Eve family bash, and we do fireworks right out here in front of the hotel and the Mueller Civic Center, and it seems like that's a very safe place to do it here, and I think we, as an EMT, we should find a safer place instead of like on the state highway to cross to go watch the fireworks, because that's a madhouse. I'm trying to get out, that's like an accident just waiting to happen, so we can find a newer area.
I personally don't like doing there because I do think it's hazardous to have people along a state highway.
I guess I'm kind of confused.
So,
if you're going to set them off at Butler Park, isn't that right along the state highway?
Butler Park. People would be parking there as well.
Moving them back to Butler Park is not going to
eliminate out back here, like we do at
someone will talk about Butler Park, they'd still be parked on the highway.
In the past, I don't know. I just remember that there were a lot of people parked in all the neighborhoods of Butler. And I'm not saying if all those codes say we can't, then we can't. I mean, if it's in residential, it was just a suggestion, but there were so many places people could see it, a lot of people didn't even leave home because the big ones. Where now, so many have to leave home, I think.
Wes?
Part of the safety problem was when they shoot those big commercial fireworks, there's a lot of hot debris that comes down, and it's raining down on people above. So it was a real dangerous situation. You got hundreds of people down there, and you got fire raining down on them. I mean, that was part of the issue. I mean, you got to keep the people away from the discharge.
Wes, wasn't there a minimum distance?
There was. As a kid, I remember going to fireworks at Butler Park. Even at that minimum distance, we still had debris falling on the spectators.
But you can have that happen up at the golf course as well with the current location.
That's incredible.
Golf course hill would be a better spot up behind there. And you can see it for a long ways.
I am definitely in favor of looking at the safest spot in the city to do fireworks. Not on a highway. Any other communications from the public? All right. Back to personnel. A through M. Any questions?
Start charging the county for all the training that we're giving the police officers they're hiring. We train them for years and then they go to the county. Shouldn't we be reimbursed?
And we need to get our wage up so that the county doesn't have the opportunity to hire away from us.
You're higher than the county now?
For this position.
We had this officer for 17 years?
19.
19 years.
Actually, I think it was right at his 20th anniversary.
Who are we talking about? The agenda actually is not on the website.
No, the packet is. Sorry, the agenda is on the packet. It's the full council packet.
Is it?
Yeah. We had a miscommunication with the public packet here. Next time you're on. Sorry.
Do we want to accept the personnel?
Just informational.
Okay. Ordinance. This is the second reading of the supplemental appropriation, Ordinance 1155. This was a donation to our parks of $1,000.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Roll call. And I'm going to do roll call. Or you will? We need to do roll call. Then it's an ordinance.
Kara Hagen? You say if you're.
Yes.
Georgia Holmes?
Yes.
Deanna Holm?
Yes.
Tim Tescher?
Yes.
Caroline Schultz?
Yes.
Carla?
Yes.
Kristen Smith?
Yes.
So we can hold it. I asked if you guys wanted to do that.
I know that they thought it was all just resign.
I don't think there's any full time.
Lotman had five days.
Those aren't full time. There's no full time.
Can we just have a motion?
Sure. You can make a motion if you'd like.
All right, I'd like to make that motion.
The personnel?
Yes.
I'll second that.
All in favor of accepting all personnel items?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We accept. Motion carried. All personnel items A through M. And we did a roll call. Motion carried for the ordinance 1155 and resolution 2015-34 to increase the top of scale for the position of police captain. The captain was now less than certified officer.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? No. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. New business. A presentation by Rolando from Air Methods. Or, yep, you're gonna, okay. Forgot regarding municipal hangar, airport hangar construction. Good luck with the mic.
I know, it's been funky, hasn't it? Good evening, everybody.
Funky mic night, I don't know.
Good evening. My name is Rolando Gomez, and I am the Director of Business for Air Weapons Corporation. And my colleague over here, Randy Bevers, is our regional business manager that lives here in South Dakota and covers this general area for us. As I said, I'm with Air Methods Corporation, but we do business here in South Dakota as Blackwell's Life Flight. So that's who you know us as in this area. And we provide the helicopter service and fixed wing services based out of Rapid City. We fly down here frequently. Now, we do plan on, we've been talking with Hot Springs Ambulance Service as well as the hospital, placing a 12-hour aircraft, 7 days a week, 12 hours a day, during peak time of our response areas down to this general region and then further south and somewhat west and east to us, to where Hot Springs is. We feel that there is an opportunity for growth here for our business, as well as the purpose of doing 12 hours is that the bottom infrastructure for us to be able to come here is a lot less. It allows us to evaluate the volumes, the need for us, the acceptance to communities and the surrounding areas for us to be able to continue to do business here. Our intent is to, our long-term intent is to actually have a 24-hour base here. And and again, part of our intent is to attempt shortly after Sturgis is to be able to place the helicopter here in mid to late August and start 12-hour operations from that point. So some of the things that we're needing to look at and sit down, negotiate, take a look at costs is it's in bad weather, and as you know here better than I do because I'm not from, from this area, weather systems move in here very quickly, but they may go out again in a half hour, 45 minutes if they don't stay here. So for us to have to fly back to Rapid City when a bad weather system comes in, really isn't cost effective for us. We need to have a place, what I call running high, to be able to take our helicopter. And right now, the obvious place would be the airport, but there is no hangar space available for us there at this point. And we do understand there's a large hangar that's there, but it's already rented out annually to another company. That we'd like to see, well, in just bad weather, can we go park it in here and wait that half hour, 45 minutes? The ideal situation would be to build a hangar, but at that point, if I'm only going to do a 12-hour base here to build a hangar, it really isn't cost-effective enough for us to be able to do that either. So again, something we need to take a look at, what can we do, and what do we need to, what kind of foundation do we need to look at, and where can we move forward with at this point. So there's a lot of things that we have to take a look at, there's a lot of things that we need to evaluate. The first option, obviously, is to find a place to be able to temporarily put our aircraft during the day. At night, we'd be flying back to Rapid City regardless, and our crew would fly in the morning, and obviously would fly through the surrounding areas. It's going to be a community asset. It will not, how do I phrase this? Our intent, and we've been speaking with the hospital, is to use your helipad to park here during the day, during this 12 hours. If they have a patient that needs to fly out, we're right there. If we get a call for someplace south to us, one of the surrounding communities, car accident someplace, then obviously we'd apply and take that patient to the appropriate location they need to go to. Back to Rapid City, they would be down to Nebraska, wherever we end up having to, it's the appropriate place to go to take that patient. So that part we believe we have already taken care of with the hospital itself. I believe that we're going to be able to temporarily have our pad there or house the aircraft there. As you know, the Hot Springs Ambulance Service is building a new building, and so we have gone into discussions with them so that when we are here for those 12 hours a day, we have a place right there at the hospital using a portion of their building to be able to house our people for our pilot and nurse and paramedic during that hours of operation. And again, I want to emphasize our intent is to be here for 24 hours a day just to build that business for us, which there again, I fall back on, then I'm gonna need a permanent hangar space as well. So I guess the point to this is, right now, today, we are looking at what is the cost to be able to build a hangar. What is that return going to be for us? We typically, as a corporation, won't come in and build a hangar. We typically look at a turnkey type of operation.
My five minutes is up, right?
Ed, you were supposed to be for this.
So, what we typically will do is a turnkey operation if we're going to put something in a full-time position, but from speaking with Cindy and the airport manager, realized that the funds isn't there to be able to do that for the city to be able to take a look at bailing that out themselves immediately, So that's where the discussion comes in. I need to put together some options for Cindy for the airport manager to be able to take a look and say, this is what we can do, what we can't do, and what we're going to be able to take a look at. So really the purpose for me being here is just to kind of lay the foundation for it. We do plan on being in this area. We do want to be a permanent part of this community. We want to be able to hire local people to be able to live here in this community, to be able to improve the tax base. We want to be able to service not just Hot Springs, but the complete surrounding area with air medical transport, critical care transport opportunities, and being able to get people to where they need to be able to be treated rapidly and quickly and appropriately. So, there's going to be more to come. We do intend, as I said, to start our operations in mid to late August after Sturgis. But we will need your understanding, your help, your ideas on how can we go about building a hangar down at the airport that house our aircraft. And the thing to think about is if for some reason we decide that we can't do business here, you want to be able to do a hangar that you guys can use for in the future. Right, something that's not just going to work for a helicopter, but something you guys may be able to use for a fixture. The other issue that we're dealing with right now is the type of fuel that we need is not available here. So again, we've discussed some potential options on how to get the fuel that we need to be available for our helicopter here. So there's just, again, just laying the foundation, wanting to be totally transparent with you. These are our thoughts. These are the things that we're looking at. This is what we want to be able to establish. Want to be able to be part of this community for a long time. Questions for me? Yes, ma'am.
What kind of air ambulance service do we have today?
We service you with either our helicopter out of Rapid City is what we come to most frequently.
You're based in Rapid and you come down here?
Correct. So we have three aircraft in South Dakota. We have two, we call them fixed wings, airplanes that are medically configured. Now one of them is housed 12 hours a day in Rosebud. The other one is 24 hours a day in Rapid City. And we have a helicopter in Rapid City as well. That's staffed 24 hours. So we put this as a 12-hour helicopter base and hopefully build it to a 24-hour service.
Can you decline bad weather?
No, and that's the purpose of why we have fixed wings. That is the purpose of when the weather system comes in order to protect our helicopter, our asset, is to be able to park it at a hangar instead of having to fly it all the way back to South Dakota to be able to get it out of the weather and then bring it back out.
One of the reasons we were looking for down here in Hot Springs is when you mentioned the weather, a lot of the times it's good here, but it's bad between here and Rapid City. So we can't get here from Rapid City with the helicopter. But if we had the helicopter sitting right here, we could get down at Scott's Bluff, we could get over to Casper, we could get to other places to the south. So that's one of the motivations for doing that, is to provide more service to this area and to be able to do that without having to worry about the weather in between at times. And as Rolando said, we also have the airport out here, so we could utilize fixed wing, which are all-weather aircraft as well.
Here's your question.
The city built a hangar for the glider club, but they signed a contract for multiple years to use it, guaranteed use. Would you guys be willing to do the same thing?
Yes, we would. That would be our intent, as Rolando was saying, was to go into partnership to sign a long-term lease agreement, so that both parties are protected, and as he said, also make it something that would not only fit a helicopter, but would be useful for other aircraft as well, if for some reason we didn't need to use it, or if there was extra space within it. And I understand there's quite a bit of shortage of hangar space at the airport already, so that would help that out as well.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you for considering Hot Springs, first of all, the Hot Springs Airport. I don't know if this is on. would it provide, would you provide jet fuel? Would that be in the...
No, what we would end up doing is trying to get with a group, and we've thrown some ideas out there to how we could get Jet A fuel here for that, as well as apparently you have a few other customers that fly in here that need it, and the feeling is jointly we may be able to build something to where it actually is more encourages other people to be able to come in here, to be able to fly in and come visit.
Great.
So we're looking at options. One option that we just threw on the table, again, we're just looking at ways to be able to make this work, is for us to put in a fuel system, for you to put in a fuel system is extremely expensive, right? When you're looking at EPA, you're looking at the ballistic proof tanks and everything, the fuel farm, so to speak, very expensive. Looking at probably $300,000-$400,000, if not more, then you have to fill it up. You know, and granted, it'll take a while to get your ROI back, but you know, there is an investment here, but and you will get an ROI back. You'll get a decent return. It's going to take a while. So in the interim, what we just threw out there is if you get a nice fuel truck that is roadworthy, that you can go fill up, and that way it's still multi-use. It's a 5,000-gallon tank. It's still multi-use. You can drive it to where you need to fuel up either at the airport or be able to go get it filled up, so you're not having to have some ship come out here and deliver to you. Again, just options, you know, things along those lines, and we're willing to help with all kinds of stuff. One of the things that we would do, though, is if we didn't have that fuel truck option, is we would probably put what we call a small fuel tank out here with permission of the airport, but we're not allowed to. So here's the benefit to them. When we fill up our own tank, only we can use it. We can't take the liability for anybody else. If you guys fill up this tank, then we would purchase the fuel from you, right? And you can still sell it to others. So there again, there's that ROI again on your part, to where for us, we're just bringing it in, we're just having a place. So again, as I said, we're trying to see what we can do to help the community as well.
I have one more question. Have we had conversation with Shedco? Maybe they can help with this scenario and possibly find an investor.
We're open to all good suggestions. We do have other, like Glenn mentioned, we do have other interested parties in jet fuel, and it's not cheap, and we do have to look at reasonable options there.
Didn't we look at this and decide against it earlier this year? Remember, this was brought up, having jet fuel here, and we decided not to do it. Why did we decide not to do it?
I don't recall.
We did talk about it, yeah, that's true, with Carolyn. And part of the reason was the stability, too. I think we had issues with that.
There was concern about the life of that fuel, using it all up in the 18-month period of time in the large tank. There's been a lot of discussion. I don't recall ever not agreeing to do it or agreeing to do it. Obviously, we haven't agreed to do it, but there's a lot of factors in something like housing jet fuel there. But we do have a seaplane there as well for fire abatement in the Southern Hills that requires jet fuel. And Ed, what was, there's a third, I know.
PBM.
A corporate jet.
But if we had jet fuel, like you're saying, where we'd sell other people, it'd have to be under a credit card system, otherwise it'd have to be banned 24 hours a day. The cost of setting up jet fuel is the main reason. It's a whole of that way. You have not the private fueling system there.
Somebody who's willing to come in here that is guaranteed use of that fuel, where in the past you didn't have somebody, you know, it's going to be more seasonal. So
right, the seaplane is dependent on a fire
right,
to use
right.
fuel, where you have history of quite heavy use
yes.
in this area, actually.
Yes, we do.
We would use some fuel.
Three times a day or something.
Right, exactly. And as you figure, at least you'll get two flights in here at least once a day, because flying in and flying out. So we do need to make sure that we have fuel that we can readily have access to. Any other questions?
Were you still considering having your own private portable game?
We are. We're still considering that. There again, it's we want to do what's best. We may end up having to do that as an interim and then get a look at other options. But you know, we would. We're still looking at something along those lines.
But that would stop you from coming down.
That is correct. Yes, sir.
I was going to say, one positive note is being an EMT that used to drive across from Zambles and looking at going to go ride with Edgemont. It's just nice knowing that we have that extra resource around there, that extra set of hands. If, like, let's, like, if I'm riding out of Edgemont, that's just a BLS basic transportation. Ambulance service, they don't have ALS, so we would call Hot Springs, but let's say all three trucks are out and we have Lifelight here, we would just get on dispatch and say, launch the bird, and they would be able to come to us pretty quick.
We absolutely see it as a benefit to the community. We're trying to make it happen one way or the other.
You have to say thank you to the whole community. We were here for the ribbon cutting or the groundbreaking a couple of weeks ago. I had the opportunity to meet with Cindy and the airport as well as Hush Springs. We've had several meetings at the hospital. We have been embraced. I can't say, you know, I've been in this business for a long time and we've always been successful whenever the community like this has embraced us and just accepted us. And it's just, we're really looking forward to a long-term relationship here. Yes, sir.
We'll get a committee together to help facilitate these decisions.
Fantastic.
And give recommendations. We have one other question over here, Bob.
You had mentioned earlier that you have three aircraft presently. Are you thinking of adding a second helicopter to what you have?
Yes, sir.
Or you
yes.
would be bringing
yes, no.
the helicopter from Rapid
this would be, down? This would be an expand, what we'd call an expansion base. We would add an additional 12-hour aircraft here.
Okay, and then the other 12 hours it would be back up to Rapid?
Yes, sir. We did.
Yeah. So it would be actually off shift for those other 12 hours. Right now we have one fixed wing Pilatus that's 24/7 and one helicopter that's 24/7 up in Rapid City. This would add to the fixed wing that's 12 hours, and this would be a 12 hour. So it would be down here during the peak times, say 10 o'clock in the morning till 10 o'clock at night, and then it would be back up there and just sitting in the hangar. But we would still have the other helicopter and airplane available up there.
What I do want to emphasize is that even though I'm talking about this being a 12-hour base, you would still have 24-hour coverage from us because we do have the 24-hour base in Rapid City, both fixed wing and rotor wing.
Your coverage that you're offering now is not going to change.
That's
no,
just
right.
that
no,
you
no.
would be
We're
adding
to
helicopter
it.
And
right.
having
that's,
it down here.
That's correct.
Yes.
Anything else?
Thank you.
Again, thank you again for your...
Oh, yeah, thanks.
Appreciate
good to see you again.
Thank you very much.
We'll continue to discuss and see what our options are. And
any of my contact information, reach out to me and we'll...
Absolutely.
I'll be here all week if something if you need me before. I leave Thursday, so I'll be in South Dakota all week.
Thank you.
Thanks
for coming
down. Thank you. I did leave a few flyers on the table over there if any of the public would like to have some more information on that. Thank you so much.
Thank you. All right, item B, discussion and possible motion to permit August 1st homecoming parade for the American Legion Auxiliary President. The parade route would be from the state home to the American Legion.
Motion to approve.
Second. Second came from Jan.
What's that?
Yeah, you second.
Well, we kind of tied.
They tied.
I gave it to Tim on 6, we'll give it to you.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Is there a discussion? Discuss.
With regard to this, this is going to be... the American Legion is going to supply all security.
By security, you mean?
The Legion riders, yes.
The roadblocks, debris.
Right.
Yeah.
That's all I have.
Okay. Good question. You agree with that, Kim, that they're doing that? Or do you know? Okay. I understand that they are, yes. Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We have another parade on August 1st.
C, motion to set public hearing for July 20th, 7:15 p.m. for temporary alcoholic beverage license application for Flatiron Market for the Vault on August 1st.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Item D, motion to approve annual operating transfers from water and sewer fund to general fund. I understand we do this annually.
Yes, we do. Appropriate authority in our budget, but I can take your question.
I make that motion.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Item E, motion to approve changing signatories on Citibank accounts. We're basically removing Debbie Romy and Eddie Nolan.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
Are we going to add the new president, vice president?
Yes, we'll make those changes at the same time. It's usually the council president and the vice president.
So we need to add Tim.
You need to add Tim to that.
Yeah.
Is there any concern about that? Item F, motion to set a special meeting of the Common Council on this Friday, July 10th at 4:30 at City Hall to discuss legal items. An executive session.
Next motion.
Second.
Sure.
We have a meeting Monday, then we're going to meeting in here Tuesday and Wednesday, and then come back and have another meeting Friday. Could we not do this? And save the taxpayers some money and just do this before our next city council meeting instead of having to spend $1,000 to do it another time?
We're not going to spend $1,000. So that's an
The council's all paid. It has to be in the paper.
It has been notified. This is when the attorneys are available. That is why and the 4:30 time, they were available that day and 4:30 because Andrea.
Right. Work. I understand that.
The attorneys need to be there for their legal discussion. And that's when they're available.
They can come before, were they asked to come before?
I gave them a 2-week time period. And this is the only day both were available.
Do they work for you or you work for them?
They have schedules and other items on their agenda. This is when both were available.
I don't think we're their only.
We are not. They're only customers.
And what, I mean, are they going to be discussing all legal matters? So if anyone on the council has a conflict of interest, they will not participate.
That is correct.
I only got a motion, I didn't get a second.
Yeah, you did.
You can't talk quieter than Georgia. That's my only rule here. Okay, any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? What's that?
Mine would be a no vote.
Motion carried. We will meet on Friday at 4:30 at City Hall. It's a executive session meeting on. All right, committee reports. Carl, you guys
did meet. Our next meeting will be the 15th at 2 p.m. in City Hall.
Georgia?
Well, I'm not sure. We had a meeting today that was not going to. It was admin finance, but we did get some information on that.
That was primarily about the audit.
Yeah, it was the audit, and we had to send a response back.
Yes.
A verbal response was given to send it back. The library, I did meet with Cindy, and there's been a lot
going on. Did you say there's an Abby meeting today?
Yes.
No, sir.
Finance Abby.
Finance meeting.
Not the Abby and Paul meeting?
No.
No.
Couldn't hear, we were all over here asking, so.
It's very noisy out there and back here, and our mics aren't working, so. Feel free to ask if you don't hear or understand.
And the reading program has been going well and is done now, actually, and we will have Cindy resigning here shortly, and that's an unfortunate thing for us, but she did turn in a resignation for the end of the month. The Mueller Center, Chris has a new hire there that was in our notes, and I just wanted to thank him again for helping at the Miss South Dakota pageant. They did thank him publicly, but he didn't have any help at that time, and he came down and did it all himself. They were very pleased with his help. Airport didn't have any meeting either. It was canceled at the last minute, kind of. Golf course, no. They've had some fewer hours because of the rain and everything for golfing up there, so that's kind of a problem. Evans Plunge, we did have a short meeting and discussed a few items, some personnel issues and some advertisement issues. We talked with friends of the Evans Plunge and volunteers a little bit. Then we had a special meeting with no one on that. And I think everything's been resolved for that.
Thank you, Georgia. Carol Ann, did you have a meeting?
We really didn't. We met informally. The chairman was not there, so we'll have another meeting and I will have board report.
Thanks. Okay, thank you. Wes, you came before? So no parks meeting. Chief will be next time, and Tim, also known as Time Tesher on there.
Yeah. I wonder if I made a motion to change that name.
You can change the name and not the time.
We had a meeting, talked about the Albany Avenue project. They were supposed to start it today. Now, I didn't go check, but that's what we were told, is they were supposed to start moving stuff in every day.
They did.
They did. Well, wouldn't look that. Engineering has went through the town, and we have several. We've formulated a new list of drainage problems around town that they're going to start working on, seeing if we can get some of the drainage done. Garden Street, they were flushing the pipes today, so they should pretty well have that closed up if we don't get a whole bunch more rain in the next couple of days. And we did discuss a little bit about the sidewalk around the new playground at Brookside. That was good.
Thank you, Tim. Misty. Misty said a phone.
Yeah. I don't really have much to report because I have been out of the office unexpectedly a few days, but we did get to meet on the phone with our auditor who has completed our 2013 audit and will be sending it to the Department of Legislative Audit for review and acceptance in May. As soon as I get that back, we present at a council meeting. So that is good progress we've made. And I definitely miss Debbie with everything that's happened this week and being out, but we're continuing business as usual.
Thanks for being here. I know it was a rough day for you.
Thanks.
Nolan.
I only have one more meeting to say this. If you do have a request for donations from the city, please come to the finance office and request a donation form. It's changed this year. All donations for 2016's budget must complete that form to be considered. Please have that form completed and returned by July 24th. The first budget hearing will be the 28th of July at 7 o'clock here at the Mueller Center. But the second one scheduled on the 30th at 7 o'clock, same place. Evans Plunge was selected by the Department of Health for a $1,000 healthy vending grant. So we'll learn more about that in the next few weeks. But you'll learn more about that tomorrow in the article in the Star. Full details will be available there. The Screen in the Green is having its second showing tomorrow night up at the library. Events start at 8 o'clock with games for the kids, and then the movie begins at sundown. The theme is Christmas in July, as it's not done, as we've been that whole month though. But Christmas in July, the movie is Elf. We encourage all those interested to attend. We had a great attendance last one. We had maybe 30 to 40 people show up, so it's a good community building activity. Lastly, I think the council members have a note in their packets about this. The new council are exploring going digital with our packets, so the council can opt in to receive digital packets. Doing a cost savings analysis, this should save us over $2,000 annually if we have a majority opt-in this, and so that should more than make up for the name plates. That's all I have.
Thank you, Nolan. I'll be very brief. There's I know discussion over here about committees. We will be redoing our committees with the new council, so watch for new dates and times possibly. There will be new chairs. Tim will be moving forward with Public Works as the chair there. The others, I don't remember off the top of my head, but we'll discuss that with the new council. I just wanted to welcome the three very new people. Don't be overwhelmed.
Can you live with me?
Yes. Breathe. We definitely welcome questions. We absolutely love it when you come in after you get your packet and ask questions. I do want to remind you what Misty said, that if you do have questions about the bills, we don't want to take a lot of time in public meeting to discuss those unless we need to. But if you have questions, Carol Ann called and talked to Nolan today. We prefer it to be more like Thursday when you get your packets, but we welcome questions. The more informed you are, the better we feel you'll make decisions, and we absolutely want to encourage that. So welcome, and that is all I have. Everything else has been said.
Motion to go into executive session.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
We will go into executive session. We have a 10-minute break. Thank you for attending.